Bob Roth, executive director of the David Lynch Foundation, has helped people from all walks of life transform their lives. This is Success Without Stress with Bob Roth on SiriusXM Indy 104.
This is Bob Roth, SiriusXM 104, Indy 104, and with Success Without Stress. And I am interviewing a very dear friend and a wonderful person and a brilliant filmmaker and actress, Miss Lena Dunham. And as most everyone will know, Lena wrote and directed the independent film Tiny Furniture and is the creator and star of the HBO series Girls. Lena has received 8 nominations for Emmy Awards as a writer, director, actress, and producer, and won 2 Golden Globe Awards for Girls. She's also the first woman to win a Directors Guild Award for Outstanding Director in a Comedy Series, and she's the author of a soon-to-be-released book by Random House, published by Random House, called Not That Kind of Girl, a Young Woman Tells You What She Has Learned. All that aside, I am really happy to be here because I want to share with you the Lena Dunham that I know. You can go on YouTube and you can see interviews that Lena has done with wonderful, absolutely fabulous, with Howard Stern and, you know, Jimmy Fallon and David Letterman. And she's the most appreciative, smart, 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 wonderful. But I want to talk with Lena about her practice of transcendental meditation. I want to talk with her about the creative process, about how she handles stress and fame and having to be so prolific. And I want to hear what she has to say. So, Lena, thank you very much for being here.
It
means a lot to me.
Thank you for having me. It's so lovely. And I knew the minute you said you were doing radio, I was like, of course. This is usually when you say someone has a voice for the radio, it means that they have a face. You're trying to say that they have a face for the radio, but you're both handsome and really great at talking. And so I was very excited by the concept that you would have a radio show because your voice has soothed me through many situations. So I'm thrilled to be here and thrilled to talk about this, which is something I get to talk about so rarely, but which is such a big part of my life.
Well, so tell me, you know, first of all, how did we meet? How did this whole thing?
We actually met, and I don't think she'll mind being outed, through Allison Williams of my show Girls, because I was looking for someone to do a meditation refresher with here in New York. I've been, for the backstory, and I'm sure we'll talk about this, I've been meditating since I was 9, and I've had a few great teachers, and before I was with you, I was spending time talking to a woman named Nancy Cook de Herrera, who was an amazing, amazing meditator and human being in Los Angeles. And when she passed away at the ripe old age of 96, peacefully and beautifully, I was looking for someone new, and Allison introduced me to you. And from our first email exchange, I was thrilled. And since then, you've refreshed my mother's meditation. You've worked with my father. I'm trying to get the rest of the members of my family in here. So it's been a really good match.
And so tell me, you know, I mean, just from the beginning, you started when you were 9 years old. How did that happen?
I started meditating when I was 9. The backstory is that my mother, who's one of 3 sisters who are from a Jewish family, but a Jewish family that is sort of spiritual adventurers, I would say. And when meditation sort of rose to prominence in the U.S. in the 70s, they were right at the sort of forefront of that movement. They learned really early on, and they managed to get their mother and their grandmother, my great-grandmother, involved too. And my Aunt Susan was working with the Maharishi on the sort of marketing and publicity side, trying to sort of make it clear to what the movement was about. And so it's been a really important part of the sort of legacy of my family.
What was Susan's last name?
Susan's last name is Simmons.
Oh, that's right.
And she was really, she like produced, there was briefly, I guess, a television show about meditation.
Yeah, early on.
Early on, and she was a producer on that television show. Uh-huh. And I would kill a man to get some VHS tapes of that and find out what exactly it was.
Yeah, yeah.
And also another little detail was that my mother grew up next door to Andy Kaufman, and so they were very close throughout her childhood and until he passed away. And he was a very avid meditator and a huge part of bringing awareness to what this was. And so he was actually the person who taught my great-grandmother to meditate and did it because he was certified as a teacher. And so he had a huge influence on my family's relationship to meditation as well. And when I was 9, I was at the beginning stages of sort of having obsessive compulsive disorder, which is something I've always dealt with. And my mother knew that meditation had been an amazing tool for her anxiety, and so she introduced it to me. And I remember, you know, taking it very seriously. Like, I'd been given, like, a great gift and responsibility as a child, and meditation has been a part of my life in various ways since then.
So let me just quickly define transcendental meditation, and then we'll have some more questions. So transcendental meditation, there are many meditations, and they have their values. This one that we're talking about, transcendental meditation, is a very simple technique. I mean, it's like surprisingly simple. People think it's, you know,
people
meditation.
People think it's like learning a sport or something.
Yeah,
but
so simple to do. Lena and I just meditated before the radio show.
It was really easy.
Yeah. So it's a simple technique. It's effortless, no strain, no concentration, no control of the mind, completely natural. There's no manipulation. Something that I like, because I'm kind of a skeptical person and at times cynical about things, you don't have to believe in anything for it to work. I want to tell that to your boyfriend. You don't have to believe anything to work for it to work. It's done 20 minutes twice a day, once in the morning to start the day, wakes up the brain, gives you the focused energy to go through the day in a more resilient way, and again in the afternoon or early evening ideally, to wash off the stress of the day and really welcome the evening and dinner and friends, you know, afresh. It gives the body a profound state of rest and relaxation, according to research, which gets rid of stress. And then the rest I want to find out from you. How has practice of TM over the years helped you?
Well, you know, I think to start from the beginning, I think, and it's funny, I have a real memory of after learning to meditate, going to school, and because I didn't understand that it was like a person had been taught to teach other people to meditate, I thought it was like, well, I saw him do that once, I can do it. So I was telling like all my friends and non-friends, like, I can give you a mantra if you want. I can explain this to you if you need me to. But I think that for me, what meditation does at the most root level is bring me back to zero and remind me of sort of my most natural state and what my value is in the world in a really core way. I think it's so easy to get caught up in the challenges, physical and material and ambition, and, you know, there's all the stuff that is sort of set up in the world to distract us from our sort of most basic self and our most basic instincts, and there's so much fear and anxiety that it kind of accompanies modern life. And for me, meditation is the thing that reminds me of sort of who I am and what we all are. And it sounds so mystical, but it's actually so basic.
When you were young, did you like being in the spotlight? Were you a person who just felt comfortable center stage? What were you like as
No.
a child?
I mean, as a kid, I spent a lot of time with adults, and that was who I felt comfortable with. I really didn't have friends my own age, and I really didn't feel comfortable for various reasons, mostly just that I had a really close relationship with my parents and a really anxious relationship with school. I felt most comfortable with them and with their friends, and then with other kids I felt, I wouldn't say shy, I would say just alone. And I think that I was not one of those kids who was like tap dancing in front of all the adults and being like, listen to me put on a play, but I definitely loved being heard and having conversations and sharing my writing. And so I wasn't like a crazy theater kid, but I was definitely someone who was like seeking a certain kind of attention or validation for things that I made, which hopefully has remained the case.
And did you foresee, I read this one great thing where you used to get all ready Saturday Night Live, because you hosted and did a great job hosting Night Live. You're fantastic. And, you know, you said when you were young, you'd get everything set up on Saturday, you have your popcorn and everything, you wouldn't go out. So
no,
did you
obsessed.
See yourself, oh, this is Lena, you know, 10 years down the road? Or were you just a kid who loved Saturday Night Live?
I was a kid who loved Saturday Night Live, who never thought I would have any personal relationship to it. And that's defined so much of my career, is that there's so many things I've gotten to do that I was a massive fan of. And they were a huge, you know, everything from Saturday Night Live to David Letterman to, you know, NPR, to like the things that sort of formed me and got me through the challenging moments in my life. Those were, getting to be involved in those things, getting to sort of be heard on those platforms, is not something I ever expected. I mean, what I always say is, like, I really think I thought that I would, even through college, that I would sort of make small movies and maybe be a teacher or be a, you know, be involved in the art world in some way, and that there would be hopefully a small group of people who appreciated and understood what I was doing. But I never imagined have engaging with the wider audience that comes with kind of working within a Hollywood framework.
And how do you, how, I mean, you like your manage is huge things. You got, I mean, managing huge things, a book, and you write and you produce and you star, and where'd that come from? That ability to manage all that stuff. And your father, by the way, says you're handling the fame very well.
That's very nice of him to say. And he can be a very harsh critic.
And her father and mother, I adore.
That's so nice. They adore you. And they are so happy that you're in their life and feel so lucky, because everyone in my family struggles with anxiety. It's sort of our family plague. Some people have a family full of alcoholics. Right. Some people have a family full of depressives. We have a family full of deeply anxious people who never feel like they have quite, at the end of the day, they never feel like they've quite done what they needed to do, beaten the system, and my parents just moved into a new apartment and their lease is a year, and my father's already having a complete breakdown about where he's going to live next. Like, no one can ever get comfortable. And so this is something that we need. And I think for me, obviously so much of what I do is because there's amazing people around me, from my family to my collaborators to my friends to the people who watch the show and engage with it. I feel lucky on all those levels. I think that for me, what meditation does is allow me to balance all of it and know that there's a space that I'm headed to that's just mine, where it's actually a lot like, it's funny, something I like about acting, I'm not, a method actor or a great sort of, I don't have great dramatist tools, but when I'm in character, something I enjoy about it is that I have a break from my problems. I'm just engaging with somebody else's, and so I can switch into the zone where my stresses have disappeared, and even if I'm acting through something that's really painful and intense, it's not what I'm dealing with for the rest of the day. It's a break. And meditation sort of has a similar function. And first season of Girls, I was so busy and so stressed that I actually wasn't meditating on set. And second season is when I did start meditating on set, and everything changed for me.
It's a little bit like an athlete. I remember the old star, Michael Jordan, who had problems. Yeah. But when he was on the court for those 2 hours, all disappeared.
Yeah.
That was it. Those rules, those laws, that was all that mattered.
And I think that's something that most workaholics have in common. Like, their work transports them in some way, but when the problems come in is the fact that they're using work as a way to avoid the rest of their lives, and then they can't integrate the part of themselves that's at work with the part of themselves that wants to take care of their family and love the people around them and be a good friend and daughter and sister and wife. And so their work is in some ways at odds with their personal life, and it creates this tension. And so what I'm sort of always striving for is to be able to sort of integrate all the parts of my life and not compartmentalize too much, so that I don't constantly feel like I'm neglecting something, because that's the worst feeling.
The thing that I think, because by nature I don't want to disappoint people, it's my personality.
Yeah, you and I have talked about that. We're both people pleasers.
Right. We thank people more than anybody. So at the end of the show, we're going to thank each other so much.
Profusely.
The last 10 minutes we'll be thanking.
Just see thanking each other back and forth.
That's right. But, I mean, I don't mean to add this to you, but so much pressure. Now season 3 was great. I love season 3.
Thank
season
you.
Four. Now, those ideas come, where do those ideas come from? I talked to David Lynch about it and his tie-in with meditation, and he says he wrote the book Catching the Big Fish.
He says
in the quiet of his mind is where those big ideas, like big fish at the bottom of the ocean, that really inform something great, and this little fish or swim at the surface, like little fragment ideas, superficial creativity on the surface. So where do your ideas come from, and does meditation help with, transcendental meditation help with that?
I mean, it's always a mystery where creative ideas come from. Sometimes you have to really struggle. Sometimes you're walking down the street and it occurs to you. Sometimes you think you have the greatest idea in the world, and then you share it with your collaborators and they look horrified and you realize that it wasn't actually so good. And for me, it's funny because, of course, except for the most disciplined meditator, there's always a day that we all don't want to do it. There's tons of things that are good for me that I don't want to do, like eat well or sleep or meditate, or like it just seems like too hard. Somehow it seems easier to make the in quotes less healthy choice. But I often find that if I'm sort of up against the wall creatively and don't understand how to fix a problem and feel totally at a loss, if I meditate and take that time, when I emerge, the idea has sort of almost happened without me, because it was sort of in there the whole time, the solution, and meditating allowed me to calm all the noise around it and let it emerge. And that is one of its greatest uses, because I think that stress and anxiety and fear of disappointing people, all those things are at odds with creativity. And I think a lot of people think, and I used to be one of these people, that think that they're creative because they're suffering, when really that's actually so antithetical to making things that you're proud of. But there's so many people who are caught up in the idea that if they're happy in their family life, or if they are in love, or if they aren't, you know, shrinking themselves into oblivion every night, that somehow the magical thing that they have that allows them to make art is going to disappear. And I think I used to be sort of fall victim to that idea. Now I realize that calming all that anxious noise is actually the thing that allows me to make stuff, and that I've actually been creating in spite of all that, not because of it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's an interesting thing, the naturalness, you know, like transcendental meditation, it's a natural process. And I find, and I talk to meditating, whether it's athletes or Jerry Seinfeld or different people, Paul McCartney, people who've been at the top for a long time, they find that if they get out of the way, you know, those most creative moments, is when it's a flow,
yeah,
and you're not having to muscle it and strain. And stress and anxiety choke that. And I think one of the reason why people love you so much, the same reason why they appreciate what David Lynch does, or, you know, whether it's anybody, Howard Stern, you are yourself. You know, it doesn't matter what people say about it, you are yourself, and your power is in being yourself, just like David's power is in being himself, true to yourself. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who was the physicist who became the great meditation teacher, always said, greatest power is being true to yourself. You know, meditate and be true to yourself. Do what you know to be right. Don't compromise that. And I think that's, for me at least, that's what meditation does, is it regularly you reconnect with yourself, and when you've done that, everything, all the nuance and the noise sort of falls away, and then what's right becomes quite clear. Whether it's right, oh, this is how I want to shoot this scene, or this is how I want to be with my boyfriend, or this is how, yeah, I want to live my life, it just becomes clear.
It's funny, because when I've mentioned, you know, now because of my job, I get the opportunity to be around a lot of very intense, very ambitious people who have all different kinds of motives for wanting to make things, and some people want to make people happy, and some people want to be rich and famous. And it's funny, when I mention meditation, people's eyes kind of light up, because there's all these people who are clearly looking for anything that will give them kind of superhuman productivity and power. So the thing that initially attracts them to meditation is sort of a part of, is their sort of baser instincts, but once they do it,
exactly,
they find these other,
exactly,
these other things coming to light. So it's really interesting to see all the people who are attracted to meditation, because they go, I want to be able to sleep less, make more money, have it all, and then suddenly they're meditating and they have an insight into their other behavior that they didn't have otherwise.
No, and these other qualities of, I mean, even more abstracted, they wouldn't even, but, you know, kindness or friendliness or compassion, other things which are, don't need to be antithetical to focus and determination, mm-hmm, and, you know, and achieving great things. You can be an integrated person. And I think, again, that's something that when I watch you on the clips, or I see you live and watch your show, Lena is Lena, you know, and you are all those qualities.
I think the scariest thing to me about this job was always the idea of changing in some way that wasn't controllable to me. Like, you know, the warning stories you hear of someone like started working in this industry and suddenly their friends don't recognize them anymore and they're monsters who can't hear the word no. And I think I've been hyper vigilant about that and sort of, but I also think that staying in touch with these old habits, staying in touch with this old habit of meditating has just been a constant reminder. And every time I do it, I kind of remember why I started, which was like being an incredibly scared, stressed out 9-year-old child who was having so much trouble living inside my brain and inside my body and looking for a way out. And that was, you know, it's very easy when you have any form of mental illness, which obsessive compulsive disorder is, even though most people just say, oh, I'm so OCD, I need to have all my socks in a row in my drawer. And it's like, well, that's not actually, it's sort of how like now the new buzzword is to all the time say like, I think he's autistic. And it's like,
right,
no,
right,
he's
right,
not. And you don't know what that word means.
Or he's Asperger's.
Yeah. It's like, these are all real
exactly.
affliction. So I never want to be too moralistic, but when anyone says I'm so OCD, I want to hit them over the head with a bat. But
but in a very precise OCD way.
Yes, exactly.
That's right.
But I think that part of when you have, when you're struggling with any kind of illness, I'm sure, but mental illness is what I have personal experience with, part of your dream is you're like, I wish I could just be outside myself. I'm trapped in here in my own mind. And meditation is the closest thing I've felt to sort of escape. But what's beautiful about it is it's not like, you know, getting stoned or passing out. It's like an escape into the deepest part of yourself.
Yeah, the analogy that we use to describe it is an ocean where you have waves on the surface of the ocean and it's choppy and sometimes very tumultuous, but every ocean may be choppy or tumultuous on the surface, but at the depth it's silent. You know, you have 40-foot high waves and that's huge waves, but if you do a cross-section, the ocean's a mile deep in reality, yeah. And those 40-foot waves are nothing in that perspective, and then the depth of the ocean is silent. And we say the same with the mind. The surface of the mind is the worrying mind, the anxious mind, the creative mind, but it's the choppy waves on the surface. And what transcendental meditation or any meditation that's properly done gives access to the level deep within every one of us of our own self, yeah. Quiet, settled self.
Well, yeah, when you explained that to me, it really put words to a sense that I'd had for a long time. And I think that we, you know, I think that another big thing that meditation's done for me is I always have had a really extreme fear of death. Like, it's just been one of my greatest anxieties, has been a constant focus on sort of the fact that we're all going to die, and that has been something that's been very hard for me.
Even as a child?
With. Always. From the minute I understood.
Minute you were born.
Basically.
Yeah.
I don't remember a time where that's not something I was aware of and thinking about, which, you know, I would not wish on my child. I hope to... Like, you know, some kids don't know that Santa doesn't exist till they're like 11. Maybe I can just not let my, I can have no one mention death around my children until they're 11. But I think that, you know, for me, what was a really big thing about meditation was that I suddenly had I've never been someone who's been able to comfort myself with any kind of traditional religion. It's not how I was raised, but furthermore, I'm not an atheist per se, but I don't have a logical connection to any sort of major world religions or fringe religions. I needed to make sense of it within myself without the help of any sort of gospel.
Sure, sure.
And I think that meditation connected me to a part of myself that felt eternal and whole and not affected by sort of changes, and that it's, again, very hard to put words to because it's very deep and instinctual, but that's been something that's provided me a lot of comfort. I no longer wake up every day thinking, is today the day I'm going to die? Mm-hmm. Is this, you know, it's a part of my consciousness, which I think and believe is healthy, but it's not as fear-based as it once was, and that's definitely been a product of meditating as an adult.
I think one of the things I want to revisit, because one of the things that happened to me, I started meditating when I was 18, were 9, and...
same difference, we were both really young.
And the thing, but I'm 3 times as old as you know, or twice. The whole idea of losing myself, losing the truthfulness, losing the simplicity, the connection with myself, with what's right, with that I feel good about myself, that I'm living an honest life, and that I'm not getting caught up in any, seduced by money, fame, power, wealth, any of that stuff. That was my biggest fear as a young person, because you give up yourself for what? For some passing, okay, now you're at the, as Paul Simon said, every generation throws someone at the top of the pop charts.
Yeah.
And it comes and goes, it's so ephemeral, and yet it can be so seductive. You know, there's Lena on the cover of Vogue magazine, there's Lena doing this. That you've handled that, has it been a challenge? Because you, again, this, in a way, you've been working for this your whole life, but in a way, it just happened. I mean, you made, tiny furniture, and then Judd saw that, and then all of a sudden you got a contract, and then it was a hit. And
I mean, I think that I've stayed so connected to the people around me, and I've also always been working. I've always, from the minute that everything started, I've been working on the show, and that just keeps me incredibly focused, because I'm just thinking about what is the most sort of honest and what's the most honest, intelligent, and exciting choice that I can make for these characters? And staying involved, like the fact that, you know, when every season of Girls is airing, I'm working on another season of Girls. It's just, it's a really helpful cycle. I think it would be really dangerous if I was just sitting alone in my apartment with nothing to do but Google myself. But I'm really lucky that that's not, I mean, of course, we've all Googled ourselves. It's just a natural instinct. But it's a really, really lucky thing that I've gotten to stay so engaged with the work, because there has been a lot of unexpected attention, energy, and controversy directed at the show, and... Are you okay?
You're a wonderful interviewer.
Are you okay?
This is Success Without Stress with Bob Roth on SiriusXM Indy 104. Celebrities, CEOs, veterans, and students have learned through Transcendental Meditation that we can all live in a world free of worry. This is Success Without Stress with Bob Roth on SiriusXM Indy 104.
This is Success Without Stress. I'm Bob Roth, and I'm here with Lena Dunham.
Bob had a little coughing break, but we're back.
I did.
It was elegant.
An elegant coughing break because I ate organic grapes, which I love.
I did too. I couldn't believe how delicious they were.
Mm-hmm. Lena likes to freeze the organic, the grapes.
I do.
Just marvelous.
I think it's the best snack, and it really, you take your sweet time. It's one of those tips they give you on diet websites, so I never want to promote it because it's like... what they would tell you in like some magazine where they're like, lose 15 pounds in 5 hours, but it is delicious.
And you described a grape as self-contained.
It's so good. It's so
I
much
like
goodness.
I know.
And so, without relying on anything else, it's just so what it is.
I have no idea what we were talking about before we went
on. Talking about before was all the energy and the attention that's been directed at the show. And
do you handle criticism well? Do you handle, is it crush your heart? Is it?
I don't handle criticism well in my personal relationships. I'm like, I really hate, like when somebody tells me that I've done something wrong, I'm like, I'm sorry, but here's the 18 reasons why I had to handle it this way. Like, I'm just not... When I was a kid, it was funny. My dad would always know if I was angry with myself because I would scream at him.
Oh.
He'd be like, you're screaming at me because you... Like, let me look in your backpack. It's clear that you've not done 3 weeks of homework. Like, there was always... That I was... directed my anger that I had towards myself for not being responsible or not being focused... outward and sort of blame the people around me. But, you know, considering that unfortunate tendency, which I've been working on my whole life, I actually think that the criticism of the show, it must permeate, but I'm not, because how could it not? But I'm not hyper-conscious of it on a day-to-day basis. Like, I really don't feel like it's prevented me from expressing myself clearly or saying what I want to say about
the show.
Because
I don't think I have thick skin. I have, like, often no skin, but it never gets in the way of... me doing what I know to be right. You know, I feel it, but I just fine. That's the way it is.
A lot of times you have to feel it and just keep going because you're like, I don't have another choice. I'm not going to, you know, I'm not going to steer my ship in a radically different direction because some people on the internet made a bunch of noise. And then there's times where criticism, like I've really had, it's funny, I think learning to hear criticism about the show has made me a little bit better at hearing it in my day-to-day life, because I think my biggest fear used to be admitting that I was wrong. Like somehow... I wasn't a real person if I hadn't made perfect choices that totally reflected my values at every turn. But the fact is that's impossible. People always say life is short, but it's actually really long. And there's a lot. Some days really long. And we're put in circumstances that we never imagine. And we don't always make perfect choices. And it's a special kind of challenge to navigate that publicly. But it's also like, if that means that I get to make my work, then I feel really lucky.
I'm going to make a change here and go back to your dad.
Yeah.
I taught Lena's dad Tip to meditate, mm-hmm. and we just immediately like hit it off.
It was the best.
He kept telling me, if I had known what TM really was before, I don't know why I haven't started. I mean, was he resistant?
You know, I don't remember him being consciously resistant, but I think my dad is someone who sort of grew up with, I wouldn't say he's a full atheist either, but he grew up sort of in opposition to sort of a, you know, classic Protestant upbringing, didn't want to go to church, felt he was like a little bit radicalized. And I think the idea of anything that I think a lot of people hear meditation and they think they're going to be fed a lot of sort of spiritual mumbo jumbo or cultish behavior, and that was just so not in line with his interests, and that once he realized that there was nothing he had to believe in except his own ability to make changes within himself, then he felt comfortable. And now it's really great because...
How has he changed, or has he changed? You were commenting earlier about...
I think that he has... he's always been prolifically creative, and it's been a huge inspiration to me. He's one of those people who day in, day out, goes and does his work and doesn't sort of wait for the muse to strike. But I think that some of the anxiety that we all experience around change and the vicissitudes of everyday life have become easier for him because he has this tool. And that's something that my mom and I have known about for a long time, so it's really nice to sort of welcome him into that fold. And to know that, like, my parents are meditating together, nothing makes me happier than to know that they share a lot, but the fact that they have that shared outlet is really meaningful to me. And then another thing that's been amazing is working with you and learning about what the David Lynch Foundation does was the first time I understood that meditation could be a gift you gave to other people, and that it had power outside of just sort of personal fulfillment, like that it had kind of the potential to change the world. And that was really exciting for me to realize that it wasn't just like getting a personal trainer and it's like, now I feel so much better, but that in fact giving the gift of meditation to other people, like, that it's... I also think a lot of people hear that and they think meditation is, you know, a fancy rich person's
Upper East Side
thing, because it's like, who has 20 minutes twice a day to, you know, in quotes, calm themselves down. But realizing the benefit that meditation has for veterans, for abused women, for women, for people in at-risk communities, that has been a total mind blower that I never predicted or expected, and that's been really thrilling.
Lena's talking about the David Lynch Foundation, which was established by the great filmmaker David Lynch 9 years ago.
Who was always a favorite. He and my dad and I actually watched Mulholland Drive like 8 times the year that it came out, so we had this whole connection to his work without having any understanding that he was a meditator and that that was a part of his life. And so when I read Catching the Big Fish and sort of connected the dots, suddenly my attraction to his work, because something I always loved about his work was sort of the careening nature of his ideas and how he seemed open to every impulse and influence. Like, there's something so, even though his filmmaking is very stylized and specific, there's something so radical and uncontained about it. And I do think that I recognize the mindset of a meditator in that work.
No, and he'd been meditating 30 years, and he really, for his own sake, loved it for the creative process. He said it gave him access to the deepest reservoirs of his creativity. He actually hasn't missed a meditation in 38 years or something like that.
I cannot claim that.
No.
I missed a meditation yesterday, but it's interesting, and it was funny when I did one event with you guys at the David Lynch.
Yes, it was for a fundraiser and a public awareness for our program for women and girls who are survivors of domestic violence. And before you say something, Lena, you spoke fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It was really fun, and it was a delight to watch all these intense type A women, you know, MSNBC commentators and college presidents and magazine editors talking about the way that it had shifted their life and kind of pulled them off the sort of achievement treadmill and given them a new perspective. But it was funny because I've learned the lesson over and over that the media sort of always wants to find an element of controversy, and it's pretty impossible to avoid. But when I did that talk, a bunch of articles sprung up that were like, Lena Dunham's mother wouldn't allow her to take medication and forced her to meditate. And I was like, that is 100% not true. I was totally on medication. And my mom was also trying to hit it from every side because she understood that without attention, medication only goes so far. And so they were sort of trying to paint me as some kind of Christian scientist who was like, cure your cancer with meditation. And it was so funny for me to read that. Well, I was having a tweet interaction with my friend who was like, they basically made it sound like you had a Wiccan mother. And I was like, if people really understood that it wasn't like a man in robes carrying me around trying to cure my OCD with his mind, I think they'd appreciate it more.
But I think what's happened, I think it's because you and others standing up and saying that you meditate, is that just in the last few years, there has been the tipping point is tipped, I think, and meditation in general and the technique that, you know, we practice, transcendental meditation, there's such a level of receptivity. And I think one of the reasons, another reason, in addition to people like Lena, who is respected and loved by so many, is the research. I mean, the fact is, the science cuts away all the mumbo-jumbo, and when the fact is, you have hundreds of studies conducted and published on this technique that shows that it reduces stress, reduces anxiety, reduces depression, and helps in the treatment of bipolar disorder, in attention deficit disorder, and autism, all these different things, in high blood pressure, and actually wakes up the brain. Then you've got things like the National Institutes of Health have given almost $30 million to study the effects of TM on stress and heart disease. So it's a new time.
At the airport, you know, flipping through some trashy magazine, waiting for my flight, and it's like, try the technique all the stars are doing, and then it'll like be a funny description of meditation, and it's just, you know, whatever has to happen to get it out into the world. But it's so funny when it's on the same page as like diet tips and a, you know, carbohydrate-free diet, just because it is so ancient.
And one of the things that I think is interesting, I was out speaking at the California Endowment Foundation, which is the fifth largest foundation in the country, and their whole focus is what can be done to aid and promote the health not only of people of California but all over the world. And they've identified as the number one health epidemic in America and the world, toxic stress.
Yeah.
Not AIDS, not breast cancer, but trauma and stress. And somebody else called, another organization called stress, the Black Plague of the 21st century.
Well, it's funny. I think so many people associate the concept of stress with like, I'm in my office all day, I have 3 blackberries, I can't get home to my babysitter, and stress.
You should see her expression right here. It's too bad it's not on video.
It's like I was doing a really poor Upper East Side mom imitation. But what they don't understand is, you know, PTSD is post-traumatic stress disorder. Women who have been raped are experiencing stress. Stress isn't, you know, a fancy white people problem. Stress is an international problem that comes from trauma and abuse. And, you know, stress is the same word you'd apply to people in war-torn countries that you'd apply to people who are worried about getting to their soul cycle class on time.
Right, and now actually they're sort of identifying that they have a whole spectrum. So you have trauma on one end, then you have toxic stress, which is to the extreme, and then you have stress because you're caught on the 405 or the FDR and you're late and I'm going to miss my appointment. But the fact is that all those degrees of stress, even for the person on the 405 or the FDR, that stress is very toxic. And that stress, the mother or the father that comes home and yells at the kids, and then it destroys life.
Well, it's interesting. We, on the set of Girls, it's really important to us. Jenny Connor, who's my partner in Girls, who also started meditating with you. And
yeah, she's great.
Your colleague, Joanna Pitt, and she's incredible, and she's my best friend. And, you know, something that we see is that the film industry, people often act like we're going in to put out fires. I mean, people work 16-hour days, they don't eat well, they don't sleep enough, and it affects you, it affects your decision-making. I mean, something that's, not to make too great a leap, but something that's really been important to Jenny and me to discuss is that this year there was a very tragic death in the film industry of a girl named Sarah Jones, there was an accident that happened on a set because an aide and assistant director and a producer made a very poor choice to shoot on a train track that they said was where they said the train wasn't active. It was, and a bed that was laid across the train track was shattered and Sarah was killed. And that is, on a very basic level, the negligence of one person, but the fact is in the film industry, people are sleep deprived, anxious, and making bad decisions as a result. And the fact is you do have to wonder, I mean, I know on my set that I work with people whose safety is a huge priority for them. It's very hard for me to imagine that happening, but you do have to wonder if someone's anxiety, sleep deprivation, and desperation to get the job done prevented them from making a smart choice. And so for Jenny and me, it's really important that our set be a place where people feel like they're not being harassed to work at some pace that makes it impossible for them to feel calm and to do their best work. And so we've really been talking about a way to introduce meditation to our crew, and to, we already, you know, yanked the donuts out of craft services, but now we had exercise classes available. It's really important to us that people feel a lower level of trauma and exhaustion than we have seen on some other sets.
Yeah, and it's interesting. We're on a collective level or organizational level, this meditation is in your industry. So Ellen DeGeneres has all of her crew meditating, and Great. Dr. Oz has all of his crew doing TM, and Oprah had 400 of her employees doing TM, because it is that constant.
You can't argue with what Oprah does.
I'm not.
If Oprah's doing it,
I'm not arguing.
Good. Good. Oprah will, she will fly a drone over your space.
Very, very powerful woman.
No, she's amazing.
But it is, and then just to sort of wrap up here, it's very interesting to me. So we have the David Lynch Foundation, who's dedicated to providing scholarships for any at-risk person to learn to meditate. And we've now provided scholarships for over 500,000 inner-city school kids, not just in the United States, but all over Latin America. America, the West Bank, Congo, and working with women and girls who are survivors of the crime of all time, which is domestic violence. And
that's the part of what you do that's been so important to me, because I think when you're in a position to be heard, you really have to make a choice about sort of which charitable endeavors mean something to you, because the fact is, any charity anyone mentions to me, I go, that sounds great, I'd love to, but you have to really focus your efforts so that people hear you when you speak. And so to me, I really turn my attention to the health and safety of women, because that's the area that's kind of the
And say what you're going to do on your book tour with this.
I'm so excited, because my book tour, sort of, we're just starting to plan it, but...
Talk a little bit about your book, too, just quick.
Well,
I know you got to go.
I wrote this book, which is a series of sort of essays that involves, you know, personal stories, cultural criticism. It's essays, it's called Not That Kind of Girl, about my life and sort of my perspective on being a woman in modern times. And so I really want my book tour to reflect sort of, my book's super personal, but I want my book tour to sort of reflect some of my political beliefs, which are that, you know, every woman should have access to birth control and family planning, and to be able to make choices about their own body, and that every woman should be in a position to protect herself and minimize the stress and fear that comes historically with being female. And so something I'm hoping to do on the book tour is to partner with Planned Parenthood, to work with you guys, to promote some of the resources that I think can be the most helpful to women who are placed in dangerous situations. So,
well, I am personally very grateful for everything that you're doing for the David Lynch Foundation.
It's an honor.
And you can see some of the work that Lena is supporting at davidlynchfoundation.org.
Which is a great place to visit and very soothing.
Yeah.
Very soothing website, if those two words can go together.
And then for more information about the meditation, you can go to tm.org. But mainly what I want to do is, say on behalf of so many people, but Lena, you are a beautiful soul.
Thank
a beautiful
you, Bob.
Woman.
I love you.
Yeah, no, a beautiful woman, because of your truthfulness, because of your naturalness, because of your willingness to be transparent, and your ability to handle so many pressures and so many challenges in such a graceful way. It's a wonderful role model for young women and girls who are seduced or tantalized by fame, and they think, oh, they have to look this way or behave that way, and it just takes them away from themselves. And you being established in your big self and being true to yourself is a message, and you're at the right place at the right time. And I love you very much, Lena Dunham.
Thank you. I love you, Bob. And now we'll do our 10-minute thank-off. Well, the credits.
That's right.
Thank you. We should have done like a song, a harmonic song of thank yous.
Anyway, and have a great weekend.
Thank you. You too.
This is Success Without Stress with Bob Roth on SiriusXM Indy 104. Bob Roth, executive director of the David Lynch Foundation, has helped people from all walks of life transform their lives. This is Success Without Stress with Bob Roth on SiriusXM Indy 104.
Welcome back to Success Without Stress. We just had that wonderful 40 minutes with Lena Dunham talking about her experience meditating, practicing transcendental meditation. I've had a lot of people call me and email me after these shows requesting a little clearer definition of what transcendental meditation is, how you learn it, where you can get some more information. So I just want to take a few minutes and give you a little working definition, if that's okay with you all listening, you know, in your cars or at home. There are many types of meditation. Science has now identified many types of meditation. This is a boon because for a long time it was thought, well, if you just close your eyes for 20 minutes and it doesn't matter what you did, the benefits were the same as long as you just took 20 minutes out from your busy day. Well, it turns out that's not the case. It turns out what you do during those 20 minutes is essential. Just like if you have two white pills, you can't say, well, they're white pills. They look the same. They produce the same results, same effects. No. Because what the ingredients are determines the outcomes, the effects. So the three different types of meditation. One is a concentration form of meditation, which a lot of people associate with like Zen or, you know, the whole Hollywood thing of clear your mind of thoughts and somehow you're a yogi and there's that. Almost impossible to do, pretty much impossible to do. Who can clear their mind of thoughts? The second is called an open monitoring type of meditation, and that's traditionally or, you know, modernly known as mindfulness. And mindfulness is a nice thing. It's a sort of an observational practice. You observe your thoughts, you observe your breath, you observe your environment. It's to take a break from the action and be sort of more mindful of what's going on around you. And the third, what Lena and I were talking about, is transcendental meditation. That's a simple, effortless technique that doesn't involve any concentration or control of the mind. It's not simply an observational tool. It actually allows your active, excited, sometimes agitated, worrying, gotta mind, like choppy waves on the surface of the ocean, it allows you to settle down and experience quieter levels of thought and then experience a level of your own mind that's always there, that's calm and peaceful and wide awake, that's said to be the source of our unbounded creativity and intelligence. So transcendental meditation just gives easy access, like a gentle dive within. And when you experience quieter levels of thought, then because the connection between your mind and your body, basically one, if you're anxious in your mind about something, your body is tense. Because your mind is quieting and calming down during TM, your body gains a state of rest, according to an enormous amount of research, far deeper than the deepest part of deep sleep. And that allows stress and tension and anxiety to be dissipated. It gives you more energy. It also wakes up your brain, so you're more focused and clear thinking. The interesting thing for me, I've been meditating for 45 years, is that I went into it. I'm quite a skeptical person. I don't really believe in much of anything if just someone just tells me. Some of my friends even think I'm sort of borderline cynical. That when you learn TM, there is no philosophy. There's no change in lifestyle. There's nothing you have to believe in. You can be 100% skeptical about the technique, and it works just as well as anything else. So that's an important point. So if you think, oh, I'd like to do this, but I'm skeptical, or I'd like my husband to do it, but he's a skeptic, you know, you can be skeptical about gravity, and you drop a tennis ball, and it still falls. A few other points that come up. This is not a mass meditation. People say, well, can I learn this from a book? Can I learn this, you know, from a CD? There are a lot of, I call them mass meditations, where you can, you know, someone can say, well, just do this, or a guided meditation, or you see it on television. And by and large, according to research, those mass meditations don't work. Transcendental meditation is, as it has been for thousands of years, is taught individually, one-to-one, with a certified teacher. And it takes about an hour a day over four consecutive days. And in that, you learn a technique and you gain the traction to be able to do this for the rest of your life. And that just doesn't happen when you just sort of read a book about it. So if you want to learn TM, if you want to learn to meditate, I recommend that you get a certified teacher and learn how to do it properly. So you have something that can help you mitigate and overcome stress and really wake up the creativity, unlimited creativity and intelligence you have within you. I also want to say that the people who teach transcendental meditation, it's not a for-profit organization. It's a non-profit charity. And all of the funds that you give, and there's a course fees that range, you know, from high for some people over $1,000 down to just basically nothing. You can get through the David Lynch Foundation. You can get a scholarship to learn for free if you're in need. But all the money that comes in after the expenses are paid just goes to help make this available to people who are in need. I just want to conclude by saying that I head up the David Lynch Foundation, which Lena and I were talking about. And that brings the meditation to people in society who are at risk and who would have no access to this. That means veterans and their families who suffer from post-traumatic stress. That means women and children who are survivors of domestic violence. And it means inner city school kids who really basically have no breaks in life. If you're interested, and only if you're interested, in finding out more about the David Lynch Foundation, you can go to davidlynchfoundation.org, davidlynchfoundation.org. And if you want to learn more about how to learn, find out more about how to learn transcendental meditation yourself, then I encourage you to go to tm.org, tm.org, find out everything you need, how to go about that. I want to thank you all for listening. I want to thank Lena for being a wonderful guest on the show. You've been listening to Success Without Stress. I'm your host, Bob Roth, on SiriusXM, Indy 104.